Hey, this is Mike with RPS Solar Pumps. Today, I want to tell you about our wireless tank full system. I'll give you an overview of how the system performs, the applications, and then I'll unbox it, and then we're going to head out in the field and get one installed and show you exactly how it operates. We find when we're running a wire more than about 200, 250 feet, then it really starts to make sense to look at the wireless option. With the wireless system, we simply put the transmitter at the tank, and that monitors the tank level, and that sends a signal back to the receiver that we locate near the pump, and that will tell the pump when to turn on and off. Also, if you're going to locate a receiver inside a building, then the nice thing is, and I'll show it to you in a second, is we have an antenna with about 6 feet of wire, so you can locate the controller inside of, say, your pump house, and then run the antenna outside, because it's not able to go through buildings, doors, or other concrete structures like that. So with a basic understanding of the system, let's grab some hardware. I'll show you what comes in the kit and go over all the major components. So with this system, we have four basic models. We have the daytime only operation, which is great for solar pumps because without batteries, they're only gonna be operating during the day, and so the wireless system will only operate during the day. If you have AC hooked up or you have batteries, then this is our 24-hour system. So this includes a battery, which I'll show you in a second, and so that allows it to operate 24 hours a day and even send the pump turn on and turn off signal at night. Then we have our AC versions. With the AC version, the transmitter runs on solar and has a battery, but the receiver, since we're running an AC pump, operates off of AC. We have two versions of that. We have a 120 volt AC version and a 240 volt AC version, both rated to 30 amps, which can operate a pretty large pump. We're looking at around a 3 horsepower pump. So let's dive into our 24 hour operation kit. And while I'm doing this, I'll explain some of the differences between the different units. So the first unit we're gonna pull out of our box here is our transmitter unit. You can see on the front here is our solar panel. And then on the back here, we have two more components. We have our circuit board transmitter here, and then we have our battery. And so this is what makes it a 24-hour operation. So the only difference between the daytime only and the 24-hour operation is the addition of this lead acid battery, which provides us around 4.5 days of runtime without any sunlight. If any time during that we get a little bit of sunlight, then we can quickly start to recharge that battery. Next, we're gonna take a look at our receiver. So let's pull that out of the box. And again, it looks very similar. On the front here, we have our solar panel, and on the back here, we have our receiver and our battery, and we also have our mount here, which is gonna allow simple mounting wherever we need to put this solar panel and equipment. You'll see they look very similar, so they are both very similar units. The only difference between these two transmitter and receiving units is where the wires are hooked in. So it's all pre-wired. You're not gonna have to go in this box and switch the wires around. But if you need to custom configure, we have some normally open contacts, some normally closed contacts. If you need to make those changes, we have our user manual. It'll talk about swapping the wires over for your specific application. We pre-wire it for about 90% of the applications out there. And so that other 10%, you might have to swap a wire or two in order to get it for your specific controller. There's a few more accessories in the box. We have our user manual. That's gonna go through all of the installation and setup, but it's very simple. Basically, mount your transmitter, mount your receiver, hook up a couple wires, and this system's up and running. Inside, we also have our two antennas. And so these antennas attach to the bottom of our transmitter receiver. That's very nice because you can put your transmitter receiver down low and then put your antenna up high. The higher you go with the antenna, the better the line of sight and the longer distance you're gonna get from this system. So then we have a couple other parts in the box. We have our self-drilling screws. Now the self-drilling screws are gonna be used to mount our solar panel. So on the bottom of this solar panel bracket, there's two holes. We put two screws in, and that can go into wood or metal. If you need to go to concrete, you probably wanna get some masonry screws. Basically, you mount it wherever you need to go. And then we have our shrink tube kit. The shrink tube kit is gonna be used for two parts. First, it's gonna be used to extend our sensor. So depending on the exact installation, if you need to go a little bit further with your sensor, you can use this kit in order to extend it, to attach it to our sensor inputs here, which is this one going into our transmitter. And then there's two extras, you might not need them, but if you do need to extend your wire going from your receiver to your pump controller, then you can extend this wire out using the other shrink tubing kit. So the last time is going to depend on the exact system you're using based on your application. So for the daytime only operation and the 24-hour system, those in general are going to be used with a solar pump or a VFD and soft start. So those are not going to be as concerned with the amount of times we start and stop the pump because the soft start prevents it from overheating. So if we're using one of those systems, then we're going to be using a stainless steel probe. This wires directly in our transmitter and sits in the top of the tank, and any time the water level drops below the probe, it's going to turn on the pump and fill the tank right back up. If you're using our 120 volt or 240 volt AC system, then it's going to come with a more traditional float switch. With the float switch, you can control the throw, and so we can prevent the pump from cycling too many times by adjusting that throw. So when the float is down, it's going to send a signal to our transmitter to turn on the pump. And then when the water level rises up, it's gonna tell the pump to turn off. So now if you're using your AC system, you're not gonna have a receiver that looks like this. Down below here, we have our AC receiver. This is actually our 120 volt version. And if we open up this box, we can see the same type of controller here, but a couple extra components. First of all, we have our AC to DC converter, which takes the AC power that's going to the pump and converts it to DC to run our electronics here. And then we also have a contactor. So for the 120 volt version and the 240 volt version, the only difference here is the contactor we're using. Both of those contactors are rated to 30 amps of operation, but if you're using 120 volt, it'll be a 120 volt contactor. And if your pump's 240 volts, then it'll be a 240 volt contactor. Today, we're gonna be using our stainless steel probe because we're installing this on our solar pump using the universal controller. And that comes with the RPS 200, 400, 600, 800. It also comes with some of our surface transfer pumps. It's a very common controller that also comes with an RPS 400V, 800V, and our transfer pump. And so the first step of this, and I like to do it inside, is we're going to splice the wire from the sensor to the transmitter. And then we'll bring everything outside, install it in our tank, and get our receiver hooked up to our universal pump controller. And with about 10 minutes, we're gonna have the entire system operating. So for this installation, we're only gonna need a couple of tools. First of all, we're gonna need wire strippers, which are here on our pliers. A crimper here, and I like the all-in-one tool, it makes it much easier and quicker to use. We're gonna need a heat source. In this case, we have a little butane torch. You could also use a lighter in order to do our shrink tubing and seal everything down tight. Our screwdriver for the terminals on our controller. And then we also have here our little driver. You could also use an impact driver, a drill, anything in order to put in those self-drilling screws. So those are the basic tools we need. We're gonna quickly do our splice here indoors. It's much easier always to work inside and do our splicing. We'll bring the whole kit out, and in about 10 minutes, we'll have everything set up and operating. So at the transmitter, there's only two wires. So we're just gonna need to take our sensor here and splice that onto the wire going into our transmitter side. For this next splice, we want to make sure our shrink tubing can go all the way onto our wires. So in this case, we're going to strip back our outer jacketing a little bit more. So with the stainless steel probe, polarity does not matter. So it doesn't matter which wire I hook from the sensor into the transmitter here. If we're using the float valve, then it does matter, and the instruction books tells you exactly which wires to hook up depending on the operation of your pump. So there are two crimps complete, and now this is adhesive line shrink tubing. So we're going to evenly heat it down, trying not to with our torch to burn anything. If you see a little smoke, then you need to back off and let it cool a little bit until the shrink tubing shrinks down, and then out of each side, we're going to see a little bit of that hot melt adhesive squeeze out of the end. So there we have it. We have it all shrunk down. You can see in the middle, I got a little hot there and it started to smoke. So I backed off, moved to another section, allowed that to cool, and then went back later. Now, if you're gonna leave this outdoors, I might add a little electrical tape wraps around there to give it some more physical strength. So if this gets pulled on, it's gonna put a little load on the crimps, and we'd rather have that go on the insulation. So a couple of wraps of electrical tape, we'll get that sealed up. If it's inside, you can probably leave it just like this and be fine. So let's take this equipment, we're gonna head on out to our tank and get that system running. So first of all, we're gonna install our receiver. So we ship the unit powered down. So the first thing we wanna do is we wanna plug our solar panel into our receiver here. And it's a watertight connection, and so we can screw this together. We give you a little bit extra wire in case you wanna disassemble this and install your receiver inside, say, your pump house, and then locate your solar panel outside. There's a little bit of wire so you go through a wall or other structure to move that inside. But otherwise, we just tuck it right back behind our bracket here. And then if you have the 24-hour version, then you're gonna have this battery up here. We remove the battery cover and we attach our ground wire up. So there we have it, the system powered up, and you can tell it because the power light is flashing and by default our tank full light is on. Now if I was gonna mount this permanently here, I'd be installing a post here, probably a wooden post into the ground, and then I'd screw it right into there. This panel facing south, now we really don't have to be too careful about that because it is oversized for what we need here, so it just needs to be in a bit of light. For now, I'm gonna set this down to the side, and then we're gonna wire our controller input into our universal controller here. We have the RPS 800, you can tell because there's 8 solar panels behind me. That's feeding into our RPS universal controller and then going down into our well pumping the water. We're gonna hook this signal wire into our tank full input on this controller. On your specific controller, if you have a different type, it might be an enable, a disabled. On our pro controller, it's the little pigtail. Whichever controller you have, it's gonna be the tank full or the enable disable input. We'll remove the cover, put in the wires, and then we'll be done with the receiver and the pump side. So with our sensor wire installed, we're gonna install our antenna. Super simple, take it out of the bag and attach the antenna to the magnetic base. And then again, once I get that post in, it's gonna be mounted permanently on a post. I'm gonna go about 5 feet tall with it. Our tank's located way over there. So when I permanently install my receiver, I'm gonna have that wooden post in there. Then I'm gonna put this up on top of that wooden post. For now, it's gonna be located on top of my controller. I'm gonna come back and do a more permanent mount later. So we're over here at our tank, and for the short term, we're gonna mount our transmitter here on this small pallet, and then once we get our pole mounted, we're gonna move it over to our post and get it mounted on there. But for now, it's gonna go here. I've hooked up the battery, I've hooked up the solar panel, and now I'm gonna use the self-drilling bolts to go down into the wood. So with our system mounted, time to install our sensor. So the operation is super simple here. Right now, the water level is right about here in the tank. And so when that water level drops, then it's gonna send a signal from the transmitter back to the receiver saying the tank is empty. We need to turn on the pump in order to fill the tank back up. The tank full light is normally on when the tank is full, but when it gets that signal, then on both the transmitter and the receiver, the tank full light is gonna go out, and then you're gonna hear the pump start running. In order to artificially simulate that, I can lift up the sensor a little bit, and that's sending the signal right now over to the controller. The light's turned off, and now you can see the pump turned on and it's flowing out of our garden hose. So now that pump's pumping. So in order to simulate the tank getting full, I'm gonna lower the sensor a little bit, I can feel it's back in the water. That's like the level rising in the tank. Now the transmitter's sending the signal back to the receiver, saying the tank is full, it's time to shut off. And there we have the tank full light just turned back on and the pump shut down. So there we have it. With about 10 minutes of work, we have our wireless system up and running, sending that signal from our tank back to our controller, controlling that pump and making a fully automated on and off system to keep your tank full. So we're coming out with more solar powered and water pump content on a weekly basis. Hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, hit the little notification if you want to know when one of our new videos comes out.